Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the the years are going too fast, so February is fine. Welcome to the February meeting of the Stony Brook Council. Let's start like we always do with the Pledge of Allegiance, and we'll get started. Tomorrow will lead us.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'll remind everybody we're being webcasted. What we'll do is we'll go around the room, and for those who don't know me, I'm Kevin Law, I'm the chair of the council.
Linda Armin.
For those who do know me, I'm still Jim Longo.
Alexander Carlucci.
Joe Barada.
Bob Stafford.
Ed Feldman, I'm president of the University Center.
Frank Trotter.
Right. Sam Stanley.
Good, so I'll recognize a quorum around the room, around the table. And let's go around the room with start with Susan.
Susan Blum, chief counsel.
Fred Skanga, Long Island State Veterans Home.
Ruben Bajnik, Stony Brook University Hospital.
Richard Reeder, interim vice president for research.
Melissa Wu, vice president for IT.
Nicholas Scavetta, vice president of marketing and communications.
Dexter Bailey, senior vice president for advancement.
Ken Koshansky, senior vice president for health sciences.
Michael Bernstein, university provost.
Great.
Susan Hines, president's office. Carol Lindoro, executive assistant to the president. Marissa Trachtenberg, assistant to the president for policy, compliance, and presidential initiatives.
That's a mouthful.
Carol Guzzi, UEP chapter president at the HSC.
Kevin Moriarty, chapter president of UEP for West Campus.
Matt Whalen, vice president for strategic initiatives.
Bob Magna, VP administration and finance.
Judy Grimen, chief deputy to the president and vice president for government community relations.
Great. Well, welcome. Thank you. Sam, thanks for having your team here. Always good in case you have any issues or questions, and hardly anything going on. We've been reading about it, and so I don't have anything in my chairman's report, but I'm sure you'll touch on some of the things that we've been reading about, whether it's a student protest and immigration or free college tuition and little things like that that we've been reading about lately. So I'll hand it right over to you, Sam, for your president's report.
Well, thank you very much, Kevin, and they have been very interesting times. We're going to have, Bob is going to talk about the free college tuition Excelsior credit program on Judy too. Judy will talk about the budget in the upcoming presentation, so I'm not going to spend detailed time on that. I will talk a little bit about the president's executive order on travel. Stony Brook has about 4,400 international students. It's about 17% of our population. It's skewed relatively equally between undergraduate and graduate students. These are extraordinarily important contributors to the university. There were about 70 individuals that were affected by the executive order that came from the White House that banned input from the seven countries that you're aware of. And it was unfortunate that some of our 70 students were traveling at the time of that ban, and two of them were caught in it. One was actually on a plane and about to be deported out of the United States, and that plane was held by the control tower when the ruling came in from the federal court, and that student, graduate student, was actually, after an initial time of detention, was allowed to stay in New York. Another was deported during that period back to Geneva, Switzerland. However, during this recent break, with the help both times, significant help from Senator Schumer's group, that student has now been readmitted to the United States, and so they came in yesterday, and we're very pleased. So both of those students are now back on campus safely. So that's a good outcome from what was a very difficult situation. There were other students who were inconvenienced, and at this point in time, we have advised all students on campus from those seven countries who are here now not to travel out of the country, and that the recommendation stays put for the time being during this 90-day period. And of course, the other thing that it's done is it's created extraordinary uncertainty for people who are in other countries as well, who are concerned that they could be the next on the list. So we will be following with incredible interest and everything that's going on in this area. I have been a signatory to several letters that have gone out on behalf of the university stating our concern, strong concern about this act. its potential impact on our students, its ability to recruit students and faculty in the future. One of the things that makes Stony Brook strong is we are a global institution. We recruit talent, the best and brightest from around the world. This kind of act has a chilling effect on our ability to do this. Last time I looked, we have seen a decrease in international applications this year. We think this may be related to the election and now this ban that's in place. So we are very concerned going forward about the impact. And as I said before, I joined 48 other universities, including all the members of the Ivy League, in signing the letter in opposition to this. The AAU, of which Stony Brook is a member, has signed in opposition to this. APLU, of which so AAU, Association of American Universities, APLU, Associated Republican Land Grant Universities, which Stony Brook is a member, has signed a letter as well, all of which has gone to the White House, expressing our concern about this executive order and general concerns about policies in immigration that will reduce our ability again to attract and retain outstanding individuals from around the country. So that's where we stand at this point in time. We are certainly continuing to talk to our legislative representatives about our concern about this. So we're not only are we signing on to these letters, but we're having direct contact with our local elected officials about the damage we see for this, not just for Stony Brook, not just for other universities, but we think for the entire region, for the state, and for the United States. So it remains a major concern. Questions about this? Yeah, Jim.
Sam, would you review for us the type of student visas that the 70 affected students have, and probably equally as important, what they have to do, how they're vetted to qualify for the visas and their term and things like that. So that
Matt, do you want to provide some of the information?
Yeah, so the students would come on what's called an F1 visa, and that is a student visa, and the way they apply for that visa is through the university. The university has to clear them through a government computer called SEVIS. They then, most students then need to go to an appointment in their country to be vetted by the consulate. They need to show certainly that they have the financial ability with bank statements, etc., to come here, and the consular officers in that home country vet them to come here. There are also J visas involved with this effort, and H-1B, which would be guest workers. Mm-hmm. But all of those involve fairly significant vetting process already, and applications that start here in the United States, and then the students or the workers or the exchange visitors have to appear in the consular officers in their country.
How long does that usually take from inception to granting of the visa?
Jim, I think it would differ by country. We can admit students as late as June in special circumstances and have them still get in. But that, you know, I think we allow the students 60 to 90 days, we suggest. I'd have to double check that number, but we suggest 60 to 90 days to get the process done. But it basically depends on the country itself.
I mean, the striking thing about this, of course, was that these were people who'd had approved visas, who had gone mm-hmm. through the vetting, mm-hmm. some of whom had been in the country for a decade, 10 years in the country. Fulbright scholar, one of our students was a Fulbright scholar, had studied at two other institutions. And so, you know, I think, you know, that's what I think was so shocking about this, was people who were in that kind of situation were being denied.
And some with green cards, I thought. Is that
in the initial implementation, yes, people with green cards.
As well.
And then that subsequently, the White House then at some point in time issued a statement saying they had not meant to catch people with green cards.
Joe, what's the feel?
It wasn't a waiver for.
What's the feel with all the students?
I mean, a lot of people were just frustrated. I think a lot of people had friends who were caught up in this. I mean, people are just looking like abandoning. Like, can they do? Can we help in any way? Like, we've had a few meetings with students, and we have another one on Tuesday night. They were just giving their ideas and their feelings and their input about how they think, you know, the student body should address it, how the university should address it.
Yeah, let me add that. Thank you, Joe, for reminding me. Joe gave a very strong speech on Wednesday at a rally that we held on campus, where I spoke as well. And Joe spoke then about concrete things students can do in terms of calling legislators and things like that. So he was working very hard to help
do a call for action. I think the other thing is just to mention is that the university brought in an immigration attorney who's an expert in during campus lifetime. On Wednesday, we held a session for all students to come where they can come and ask questions of the attorney on how this would impact them. We're setting up a landing website. Nicholas is working on this now, that will have Q&As on immigration for our students and faculty and staff. I should mention, because we haven't talked about it, obviously this impacts faculty and staff too. So we have outstanding international faculty that we've recruited who are impacted by this as well. Impacts at the medical school, it's across campuses. This isn't just on this side of the street. And so we're creating this portal inside, essentially, where students, faculty, and staff can come to have their questions answered about these issues. But it is, as I say, it is very concerning.
And Sam, in the rally the other day, peaceful, any issues? What was it, Berkeley?
Oh, not at all. And we had more than 500 students there. It was a very peaceful rally, and it was very focused on the issues around immigration. Earlier in the day, we had also a solidarity march from students on campus about immigration, about issues around gender equity, Title IX, and race, racism, and discrimination based on ethnicity and religion, and that march took place as well. And again, that was peaceful also. And we had a visitor. We've had in the past visitors on campus who were like Yiannopoulos, but were allowed to speak, were not disrupted. There was a counter, peaceful counter demonstration, but it was very much in contrast with Berkeley. And I think remarkable in terms of how it's responded to these kinds of things.
Now, the students, they could pretty much invite whoever they want.
Absolutely.
Like, you can't dictate what they and who they bring here. So is there anything planned in terms of any controversial people coming to the campus?
As I say, we did have someone who I think who many people would consider controversial who was invited and who spoke already. I know of no new ones coming on, but you know, we will be prepared if that happens, and Bob and his team and everyone in student affairs all do a good job. But I would again compliment the undergraduates and graduate students for their maturity and thoughtfulness in responding to this.
Great.
Kevin, before you leave this topic, just to let you know, the University Senate has a resolution before it for its meeting today also around this topic. And when I circulated that resolution to the faculty, I got several responses from faculty, one faculty member who is presenting a paper at an international conference in Columbia and has decided not to go because of her fears about the current, she's a green card faculty person, and her concerns about getting back into the country. So it's had a negative effect on our ability to accomplish our academic mission.
Yeah. And Ruben and Ken, and anybody planned on coming here for surgery or anything that is not now coming because of the issues?
We've not heard of that, but we also have employees and, for example, one faculty member of the School of Social Welfare who is Iranian, who is not going on a planned sabbatical because of this, because of the fear that she won't be able to come back to the country. So there are those kind of issues.
Interesting times. Sam, want to continue with your presentation?
So let's go to some good news. Some of you may have seen in the New York Times and the report on that came out about those schools that create income mobility for students. And there was a ranking of top 10 schools for helping students, particularly from the lowest quintiles of income, actually go to the highest quintiles of income. And Stony Brook was ranked 3 in those top 10, essentially, for students being able to accomplish that. We're very proud. We were only one of 2 AAU schools in that group. We have graduation rates into high income levels. For all of our students, it ended up approaching those of Columbia, for example, in terms of other elite schools. So that's, again, something to be very proud of. But our ability, again, to take a large number of students from this poorest quintile, essentially, and take them up is what was at stake here. And so there was a quote here: some colleges, such as SUNY Stony Brook, have a much larger fraction of children from low-income families, yet have earning outcomes that are nearly comparable to those of highly selective colleges such as Columbia. These colleges have very high mobility rates. They have a large number of students who come from poor families and end up with high incomes. So that encapsulates one of the goals of Stony Brook, I think,
really
something we should all be very proud of. And again, you know, this is the faculty, this is our extraordinary student body who make this happen. So we're very proud of them and proud to be associated.
You know, Sam, when I read the article, I was very excited about it because beyond and before Stony Brook, this is really the tradition of public higher education. In New York State. I'm thinking of CUNY and the people, immigrants in the 30s that came in, dirt poor. Yep. I know many older guys on Long Island who went through CUNY, and their parents didn't have a penny, and they went through and they became incredibly successful. I just think the Stony Brook is continuing that tradition in the suburbs.
We appreciate that, and my congratulations go out to our external faculty and staff and students who really have accomplished that. And
were we the only SUNY?
Oh yes, on that particular
list. On that list?
Yes, on the top 10. Yes, for sure. For sure.
The only college in New York.
In the top 10, I don't remember. I'll have to go back.
I was from New Jersey.
Yeah, New Jersey Institute of Technology or something.
Yeah, that's great. So one of the things that remains important to us in reaching these kind of goals is our philanthropy. The campaign for Stony Brook, I think, continues to progress. Dexter, do you have anything you want to add on where we are?
Yeah, so we're at about $520 million towards a $600 million goal by June 30th of 2018. Lots of hard work ahead to raise the balance, but lots of enthusiasm amongst our existing donors and our alumni base. We've been doing a lot of alumni events recently, and just a lot of good positive buzz about Stony Brook.
Great. Stories like the New York Times article. Can't hurt. Great.
I had an opportunity to go to China for a very special event. Wei Dang, who's a Chinese leader, industrialist, gave $1 million to endow the Xian Yang Wei Dang Chair in theoretical physics and physics and astronomy. And the inaugural recipient of that endowed chair, Alexander Zamolodchikov, was installed in Beijing. And we had an extraordinary turnout there. We invited a number of our students from Stony Brook who were home on vacation during that time. This was during the holiday breaks. We had about 60 to 70 students come to the event. Some traveled from as far as 5 hours away to attend the event. Xian Yang, of course, is a national hero in China, and so his presence always, I think, attracts great crowds and great, frankly, publicity for Stony Brook. And it was a wonderful event, which again, I think, showed the global nature of the university and the support we're achieving worldwide for the kind of accomplishments and the kind of quality faculty we recruit. And Professor Zamolodchikov gave a very detailed physics presentation that had been the request one day that he did. I won't summarize it for you. You're welcome.
I'm still impressed with the name you just pronounced before.
Yeah. Thank you. And then Esther Takeuchi has been named the inaugural William and Jane Knapp Chair in Energy and the Environment. I think many of you know Dr. Takeuchi. She's one of the star faculty at Stony Brook. She has more patents than any other woman in the United States. Her patents are in the area of storage, technology, batteries. And she's world-renowned for her work in this. And we're very pleased that the Knapps, Bill and Jane, who have been extraordinary supporters of Stony Brook University, along with the Knapp-Sweezy Foundation and family, have continued their contributions by endowing this chair in her name. These chairs are so important. We've talked about them before, but they really are ways to help us recruit and retain the best faculty in the world. It's an honor for them, but also provides money, essentially, to support their research programs, to support graduate students, to use as they see fit to further their research. And so that was very exciting. I'm getting further along here. We're getting to the Discovery Prize. The Discovery Prize is going to be this Thursday, February 9th at 1:30 p.m. In the Charles B. Wong Center. You remember we did this 2 years ago? This is the prize where we've created with support from the Stony Brook Foundation. It's a prize for basic research. We had a number of our young faculty submit proposals. We narrowed it down to 4 individuals. They're going to present to a distinguished panel of judges, which are Dr. Haldane, Nobel laureate in physics,
Dr. James Simons, who many of you may know, who's a former chair of the mathematics department at Stony Brook University, and Dr. Barbara Yatsik, former professor in physics at Stony Brook, who's now at Stanford, will be the three judges for the prize. This will be a TED Talk for each of the four. They'll be judged, and then the winner will receive $200,000, essentially, for their research. So this is one of the largest prizes in the country, essentially, to support basic research in young faculty, and we're very proud, and it's designed just for Stony Brook. And so I encourage you to come. It's a great show. Alan Alda will be there to speak about science, and so he'll be a guest speaker there. And I think it's going to be a great event. We did it last time in Manhattan. We wanted to bring it to the campus so our faculty and students could all attend, but I encourage members of the council to come as well.
What is that?
This is Thursday at 1:30 p.m. in the Charles Long Chapel, so it's Thursday. And again, we're very excited about it. I wanted to mention that Tim Mecklen, who's been our Dean of Students, has retired and left Stony Brook to pursue other opportunities. Jerry Stein, who many of you know, who was the dean here for decades, is returning on an interim basis now to be dean. So we're very pleased that Jerry is here. I think the students are very comfortable. Many of you know Jerry, and we're excited about that.
And that's an acting capacity?
Yes, in an acting capacity.
So what do you have,
a
search?
We're doing a national search for a new dean of students. Our dining program, we put out a request for proposals to enhance the current dining program. We've had a new vendor in Sodexo. There's been some issues around how dining has been implemented. So we put out a new RFP, essentially, to relook at dining. And we have a new head of FSA, our Faculty Student Association. And so he will be managing this RFP along with a committee of students and others. But you may hear something about this in the news and so on. That we're searching this out again. It's a very large contract. What's the size of, Peter's not here, Peter Bajan, but the size of the contract is in the tens of millions of dollars, at least 40 million, something in that range. So it's a very significant contract.
Are there Long Island companies who are capable of meeting that, and do we think about that?
We certainly do, and of course we look for minority business as well. I think we're looking for possibility of having more than one entity do it this time. In the past, generally one large entity has done it, so Chartwell did it, then Sodexo. Those are very large companies. But we're also looking at maybe some other schools have done it where they've split it into more than one vendor, essentially. So I think we're looking at those kind of possibilities too. We're open to the best for our students. And this is one of these things, of course, where it's all paid for by student dollars. So the students pay for their meal plans and they get things. So it's very much about delivering value for the students. And that's what we're looking to do, is find a company that would do that. New residence hall. So another exciting thing, on February 22nd, we'll be opening the new Cesar Chavez and Harriet Tubman residence halls. You, of course, approved the naming for those halls. I have to say they've been incredibly well received on campus. There's very much excitement about these new halls. They're beautiful new facilities, and again, you're all invited to the ribbon cutting on that day, and it's going to be an exciting event. You'll be able to see the East Side Dining Facility as well. That's our new state-of-the-art dining facility, adding to what we do.
And the kids will move in there in September or the summer? Or
So there's students in there already for the first phase. We're waiting to get students into the second phase, because that's where we are right now.
I think they're already moving in. I think we're getting close to full occupancy.
Full occupancy in both buildings now, both sets. Okay, fantastic. So we had our 40 Under 40 annual event January 31st at 360 in New York City. Months are even getting longer here. At 360 in New York City. These are incredible. It's one of these events that's really fantastic for the university. We have nominees that come from around the country. Bob was there, of course, co-chairing it with me. And we had an amazing group of Stony Brook alums, all under 40, of course. All of them incredibly accomplished, and it's just a great opportunity for them to get together. We have prior winners invited as well. People get together, they network. It's an exciting evening. We usually have one of our outstanding undergraduates do the introductions and do the beginning, and they're always great, and this is no exception. And just one of the best events I think we do, and kudos to Dexter and the team, because I think it generates a lot of excitement for the university. I want to wrap up by just talking really quickly about sports, particularly men's basketball. For those of you who haven't been out to see the team, they are surpassing expectations at this point in the season. They were picked to finish seventh in the America East, as you know. Having won the America East Conference last year, they lost four of five starters from the team. Our new coach, Jeff Bowles, inherited just one starter, as I said, lost one of the major players who played last year, started and played last year. And so we were picked seventh out of eighth. We're currently second in the conference. We're 6-2. We just beat Albany at Albany on Saturday, which is a big victory. That means we beat Albany twice this season in basketball.
So that means we're 7-2.
I enjoyed that. I don't know if they caught this in or not, so maybe we are 7-2. And Vermont's very good this year, though, by the way. Vermont is 9-0. They're unbeaten in conference. And so Vermont beat us by shade when they came here at Stony Brook, but we'll play them again this season. But it's exciting, so I encourage you to come out and see it. And our women's basketball team is bringing the second half. And I think they also are an exciting team and playing quite well. And then the other team, I think just to be on the lookout for, is our women's lacrosse team. They opened 2017 with their best ever preseason ranking. They're number 6 in the lacrosse coaches poll and number 5 in the inside lacrosse cascade poll in the country. So this is a very good team, expected to compete. The coach has said he wants to compete for a national championship. They're going to be exciting to watch this year. And then the pool is now completed. The renovations of the Stony Brook swimming pool renovations are completed. It's only taken 2 years. I can't remember three. Renovations are completed. We are waiting for the state to permit it. So the state has to come and make sure the water has enough chlorine in it and all this kind of stuff, that the pumps work. So they haven't come yet. So we have to get those state and local inspections.
Where is the pool?
The pool is right in the athletic complex, so it's in the same complex that has Pritchard Gym in it, but it's beautiful. It's been completely redone. It now has a platform floor that can raise up and down that allows you to play water polo, essentially. You need that for water polo. You need a uniform depth if you're going to play that. It now has that belt built into it. The ceiling was raised to allow you to have diving for swimming and diving. So before, the ceiling was too low to allow safe diving competition. So now that's been fixed. So it's really going to be a spectacular asset for the school. Students are incredibly excited about it. They're still coming by every day. If you know somebody in the regulatory agency of the state who's responsible for inspecting local, please let me know so we can accelerate this. That's not really, I'm just kidding.
I know.
For the live stream. And we're going to bring back, women's swimming and diving team had been on hiatus. We will bring them back now, so they'll be starting again. For the spring, we'll be able to have a women's swimming and diving team.
Is that all we have? Do we have a men's team too?
No, we just have a women's team.
What about polo? What about, is that a club or?
We're club sport, and they're excited about this. We're thinking about that in the future. We might add women's water polo as a sport as well. So we might have that too.
Cool. Got a quick question.
Yeah.
Who currently has the dining food service?
So it's a company called Sodexo. They're a multinational company, billion-dollar, $3 billion, something or more.
And their contract is up?
Well, the contract's not up, but it can be broken by each side, and so I think that's why we're putting out to bid. Is I think that I think neither side is happy with how this has been working. Well, I think neither. I would say it's fair to say neither side is happy.
Do you think they'll bid?
I don't know the answer to that question. So that concludes my report. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
Good stuff. Any questions for Sam on any of those topics? Sam, I have an unrelated question. You didn't cover it, but in light of everything that's going on in our country right now, I remember Howard from the School of Journalism talking about teaching kids about fake news and stuff like that. And it is amazing. I even see it with my youngest son. You see something on the internet, and all of a sudden they think it's true. Because it's written down. And so I teach them about, all right, what's the source? And so now he knows to look for the source and stuff. But is that a mandatory requirement? And can it be and should it be for all students here?
So that's a great question. And so Stony Brook had a pioneering program in news literacy, which received significant external foundation support. And with that support, it allowed us to provide it for many students on campus. So we did it for a lot of students. Some of that support disappeared
And enrollment from just students enrolling on their own to take the course has declined somewhat, so we've been trying to figure out ways in which we can make it more available to students and support it, but we've been looking in part for some outside support to do it. I think it could be talked about as a mandatory course. It's certainly something worth considering. You know, there are a lot of kind of required courses for students and required training for students that's built in, but certainly that's very important. But I think we, you know, and Howie himself taught some of the course. I think the news literacy course was a powerful course going forward. And I think some of it is transmitted, and so we have been doing some courses and outreach related to fake news and what is fake news. And again, I think that's been a focus of the School of Journalism. But I think that course, in terms of giving it to everybody, has been something we've talked about, but haven't really had the financial resources to do. I don't know, Michael, if you've had a chance to deal with that.
And Howie and I we're continuing to talk about this, Kevin. And part of the challenge is, you know, we've got orientation platforms for the students, and as we add to them, you know, they begin to grow into like week-long, 2-week-long. We have to pick and choose. But I know Howie and I agree with you that the time seems right to revisit this.
It's an,
really think closely.
It's an elective in the School of Journalism now?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The issue is, Kevin's point is, you know, should this be a required
No, I got his point. I met the professor, who lives in Bellport, by the way, Frank. He was from Time Magazine, I believe. I don't remember his name, but he was incredibly impressive. I met him at a cocktail party and was entranced by for about 20 minutes, yeah.
And there are a number of people, not only in our school, but nationwide, and our school is connected with these people. What's interesting is not simply to look at the training, but to do data analysis. You know,
yeah.
We pull the students before they take a class like this, and then we pull them after, and you start to be able to measure some of the impact that this group.
Yeah, I don't mean it as a, you know, in any way as a partisan thing. I just, you know, the kids, they're growing up in a different world than we grew up in. They're not reading newspapers, primarily. They're getting all their information from their phone.
And Facebook, yeah.
And, and all these other sources. And so, listen, you know, it's not all of them need this. But you know, I would think the majority could use it. Especially
I think everybody could. I mean,
yeah.
I think you're. I think you're right on target. And again, I think the course that they developed, and I sat through a couple. I had the opportunity to be at a couple of the lectures in the series. You know, were very powerful in terms of pointing out how stories are put together, what kind of biases can be built in, and helping you detect, just as you said, what's real, what's not real, what are the questions you need to ask, you know, what do you need to know to interpret something, and is that information available to you? You know, just as you were talking about, what is the source, who's saying it, you know, where did this come from, you know, how reliable is it, all these kind of things. And again, I think they did a very good job of giving case studies to help you understand this. And so I think it's powerful. And
right.
It did have pretty strong support from several foundations at the beginning, but over time that's kind of dissipated a little bit. So I think, but maybe in the current climate, as you said, there's an opportunity to revisit this.
I actually took this course when I came in. I thought it was very beneficial, very thorough.
Yeah.
And it was a very interesting class. I think everybody who was there was engaged.
Yeah.
How do you think the kids would react if it was a mandatory, like it was a requirement, a core, Stony, what do you call them, SBU?
So now it's the Stony Brook curriculum, so but a requirement is part of the Stony Brook curriculum.
I mean, I think it would just be one of many other classes that are required. I don't think it would have that much of an impact. When I came in, it was like highly recommended. So when I sat down with like an advisor, she like just said, hey, you should take this class. I'm like, okay, sounds interesting.
Yeah.
But I don't think it would have much of a negative effect.
If it was good. I got it. All right, thanks. All right, any other questions for Sam? Thanks, Sam. Great report.
Thank you.
Great things happening here, as usual. We'll go to our special reports today. First up is Judy, legislative agenda items.
Kevin, can I just point out that we skipped the approval of the minutes? So
you know, I always do that, Ed.
Did you do it purposely?
No. It's a mental thing. You know, it's not the first time I've done that. I go from, you know, we go around the horn, and then somehow I skip this. So next time I will make sure, right after the pledge, we do the approval. Here's what I do.
Or I'll be here.
First, I like to recognize the quorum, and then I should go right to the minutes. But then I let the others introduce themselves. and then I go to the rest of the agenda.
Motion to approve the minutes.
That's a long-winded motion. And I'll make it myself, seconded by Father Alex. All in favor of the approval of the minutes?
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries. Thanks, Ed.
You're welcome.
Next time, remind me before. Okay, now we'll get to Judy.
Okay.
No motion needed.
Excellent. So I'm going to give you sort of the speed read of the state and federal budgets and what's kind of happening there. Very early in the session, certainly in Albany, so I've just selected a few things to highlight, and it's going to be a difficult legislative session, in part because there was no deal on legislative pay raises prior to the session, so that's playing out in many different ways throughout the session. I'll just start by showing you what Stony Brook's legislative agenda really is. We have really a narrow focus this year on regaining the tuition authority, fighting off any excessive regulation, getting capital funding, particularly for critical maintenance in the new engineering building. And I would add to this that we also are looking to make sure that our DISH funding for the hospital is actually coming through at the full amount as opposed to the amount that we've so far received, which is far less than the full amount. So that is an active situation. And also getting we have $75 million for the iDyne building that you've heard about a few times. We just don't have the final yes get going, and so we're also working on that. Which is moments away, we hope.
Judy, I'm not familiar, or I don't recall the new engineering building. That is just going through the normal SUNY capital program, or is
no,
that?
No, we're looking for a special, line item for that.
Oh, is this like a new wish list project?
So the challenge has been that there hasn't been, a SUNY capital budget, basically. So they haven't put through, in the past, we were lucky enough to have a 5 or even 10-year capital plan for SUNY, which then allocated, significant amounts of money, and the campuses would submit their plans. They would be approved by SUNY, and then we would be able to build from that. That hasn't happened in the past few years, and so that, in order to get some of the buildings we need, we've been looking, we're now looking essentially to something that would be an add-on in the budget, because there isn't, in the governor's budget, there's not a capital budget essentially for SUNY. There is a recommendation around critical maintenance dollars, but there's not an actual capital budget plan. Now, SUNY has put in a request for a major budget plan, but it doesn't seem to have a lot of traction, at least as far as I can tell at this point.
And is this part of that plan?
It would be. If that came through, then that would certainly be supported by that plan. So if that came through, yes. But in the absence of that, we really do need a new engineering building. So we're asking for a separate add-on. It's in the same way the computer sciences building was funded by a separate add-on, essentially. Right.
We did hold a legislative breakfast in our existing engineering building, and as staff person of Senator Flanagan said to me, I didn't understand why you had it here, except now I do. So after spending an hour and a half in the engineering building, he's like, I got why it's here.
There's been a 70% growth essentially in enrollment in engineering over the past, I can't remember, 6, 7 years, whatever it is. So it's grown significantly. We're really busting at the seams. This is a high demand, not just for our students, but of course for the workforce and for the region to have people who are trained in these STEM areas. And so we're really lagging behind the facilities necessary for both faculty and students. And so that's why we're putting in it.
And it's both space as well as the type of space. It really needs to be a different type of space for the kind of things that they're doing now.
And at the conclusion, I want Ken to talk a little more about the DISH issue, because it's a very important DISH. And it was late last night watching the Super Bowl or something. It's a very important issue, I think, not just for the money for the hospital, but what it means for our ability to provide important services for the region. And so I think we need to follow up on that. Because that's an important issue for us. So,
good.
Yeah.
So just some highlights of the governor's budget proposal. It's a $152 billion budget. It maintains his string of proposing budgets that are less than 2% growth in state funds. It's the Middle Class Recovery Act, focusing on key investments, helping the middle class, big ideas. This slide has some of the items that he is highlighting for investment or focus. some of the context of the state finances. There's a huge growth in Medicaid, slowing in tax, some tax receipts. Generally flat agency funding overall is proposed in the budget. Some tax cuts for the middle class. The extension of the tax surcharge on millionaires is in there. And then he's got some new ways to increase tax revenue. One is called the Amazon, well, in Connecticut, we called it the Amazon tax, which was that you collect sales tax for sales that are done online but to people in your state. That's in there. There's also a ride-sharing tax, which would allow Uber, for example, to go statewide, but a tax would be paid to the state. The other key piece is at the bottom. He's got ethics reform, so some of the very things they raised within the context of the salary negotiations are now on the table again, including putting forth constitutional amendments, limiting outside income, creating a full-time legislature, imposing term limits. So, you know, all that stays in the mix of things that they'll be discussing. From a higher ed perspective, really the biggies are the you can read some of the things that are in there, but the biggies are really the Excelsior free tuition program. It's a program that is for New York State residents. They must take 15 credits a semester. They have to earn, it's graduated, but less than 100,000 up to less than 125. It's a graduated implementation by the third year. You can't get it if you had an existing degree, so if you're going for a bachelor's, you already have a bachelor's, you cannot get the Excelsior. You lose it if you take less than 15 credits. So this is an this is a completion program as well as an access program. The goal is to get people in and out in 4 years, and it's created, it's structured in that way. It's last dollar, which means every other bit of aid has to come in first before a student can get an Excelsior dollar. It maintains what we call the TAP gap, which is we currently pay students for any students who are on TAP. The institution picks up the cost of any tuition increase throughout their lifetime getting TAP. It has some, you know, great for students' pocketbooks. There are some issues for the institutions, which we're still working through and Bob may touch on. The other biggie is the predictable tuition plan. So it's different than the SUNY 2020 in a couple of ways, but it's wonderful that the governor has included a predictable tuition plan. We need a predictable tuition plan. And it goes until 21-22. It has up to $250 for 5 years of great significance, as there's no maintenance of effort included in this, as there was in 2020, which means that in 2020 we could have tuition raised and there could be no state cuts. So in the past there had been a lot of allowing institutions to raise tuition and then cutting. So it's a wash. Unfortunately, there's no MOE in the current legislation as proposed. That is significant. We don't want to raise tuition.
And how else does it differ from SUNY 2020?
Well, the amount is different. So 2020 was up to 300. No MOE is significant. Other components, which I'm not sure exactly in that piece of legislation, but other components are that your TAP eligibility, oh, and I should say, by the way, Excelsior is only for private publics. Other components of the tuition are the TAP eligibility of the institution would be taken away if tuition and fees go up by more than $500. So, or HEPI, and that includes publics and privates. So that certainly wasn't there before. And what the significance of that is that some institutions have certainly raised fees when they weren't able to raise tuition. And so it's trying to get at that, to keep both at a certain level.
Practically speaking, there have been years where we have raised fees and under 2020 tuition that would have exceeded 500, which under this proposal would mean you lose all your TAP award.
Right.
And it's even more, you can imagine, onerous potentially for private institutions to have tuitions that are, you know, four times ours already. So percentage-wise, if they're going to raise tuition 10%, they're going to run into this immediately. If they want to raise it 5% and then have a fee increase, they're going to run into it immediately. It's a challenge across higher education.
And the privates are definitely taking this issue on.
And academic excellence fee not mentioned in this?
Not mentioned.
Yeah.
Not mentioned. And, you know, the absence of the MOE is particularly, I mean, it's always important, I think, but it's particularly important this year because there is also put in the budget an exigency provision that allows the DOB to make cuts without legislative approval if expected revenues don't come in. So it's significant.
That was Bob's dream come true.
It was. It was.
Unconstitutional.
Bob kept waiting it and trying to put it in, but anyway.
Hey, I believe the MOE was a good idea.
Good news around on the capital side, so there is a significant increase that the governor put in the budget, although most of it is set aside to go to SUNY to be distributed in an unknown as of now way, fashion. And so the goal will be to make sure that it goes to those institutions that are actually using their critical maintenance dollars. The other good one is the design build construction for some projects. So that is it. That is something that we've certainly wanted, and it's in there for some projects. We'll see if we can hold on to that because I think it's significant. There's actually an editorial today in Newsday about design build and how useful it's been for the state, and it references Stony Brook and our ability to perhaps save money on the Mars building if we had design build.
Some meaning a particular cost threshold? Like projects over $50 million or $100 million or something else?
No, I think it's more, Kevin, again, we're still looking at it because the language is kind of all over the place, but I think it's more construction fund projects as opposed to projects we would do on our own.
We're dealing with this issue right now in the building of the hospital bed towers in the Mark, and I think just based on the experience we're having, I think design build would make a huge difference in allowing us to save money.
And that was
save taxpayer money.
And that was a construction fund project, so it would have qualified under this bill to have done as design.
Just a couple other things. There's the IG is being extended to SUNY and CUNY, so that's an inspector general. And it's the language sort of gives it, allows it to review financial control policies at SUNY, CUNY, and all affiliated nonprofit organizations and foundations that have control of, manage, or receive $50,000 or more annually. So this includes, arguably, could include things like alumni associations and foundations. There are certainly some issues around whether they're controlled or not controlled. For example, our foundation is a separate 501c3 organization, but it would extend that inspector general review to those entities. On the economic development and transportation, there's, you know, again, this is a significant investment that the governor has laid out. I'll just cover the life sciences initiative is $650 million to support a world-class life sciences cluster. It includes tax incentives for companies, capital grants for lab and innovation space, early stage and operating support, equipment, technology. It's a big deal project. We certainly hope that we can get a piece of that for some of the research that we're doing and are already working on that. The Excelsior program is essentially, I think, a sort of a reboot of Startup New York with some changes. So, but there are some significant investments still within this budget. The clean water infrastructure and the wind farm, we certainly have research here that will connect with that. So I think many of these have some, what I'll call opportunistic things that our research happens to go nicely with. Some of the social issues that the governor's put in the budget, you can't see them all here, but I'll just, so the voting reform includes early voting, same day registration. New York doesn't have any of that, as many states have made the changes, so he's included some of that. There's a pay equity is really around making it illegal to ask for salary history when hiring for state employees as a way of improving pay equity. He's put money into Environmental Protection Fund, talks about closing Indian Point nuclear facility, developing offshore wind power, which again would be helpful for us. He continues a significant support of the DREAM Act and adds an Empire State Immigrant Defense Fund and a State Interfaith Council to deal with issues of interfaith. We have a number of students, of DACA students here at Stony Brook, and we have been working with them on helping them and working with them on supporting the DREAM Act, and so that will continue as well. For the hospital and the vet's home, there's a slight increase in funding. For the vet's home, there's an $18.6 million that seems to swing back and forth. The governor takes it out, the legislature puts it in for the hospital, so we will work to put that back in again. There is some additional spending authority for the hospital and $50 million in critical maintenance. There is a prescription drug proposal that the governor put in that would prevent price gouging in the Medicaid program and does some things around surcharging for those companies that do exorbitant pricing and taking the surcharge and putting it back into the program. So that's sort of new, different, creative. See where that goes. At the federal level, I think immigration is one of the big issues, and we will, I believe, continue to be dealing with that. Again, Senator, as Sam said, Senator Schumer's staff were instrumental in helping our students who are caught in this, and he has been really at the forefront on immigration, so it's quite useful to be in his state. We'll see where DACA goes, and certainly some of our students here who are DACA students are quite worried because they've essentially outed themselves. They're quite worried about what that means. It's unclear where things go on many of the other issues. Certainly I think that the president likes to many extents sort of the moonshots, the big ideas in terms of research. I think that most, when I sat with the AAU government relations folks, they said, we think that there will be decreases in some research funding, but there may be increases in other research funding. And if you can get sort of the right mix, the right match with the things that the president is interested in, there may actually be some upside to research funding. We'll see. From a regulatory perspective, there's certainly concern that the loan programs will go out to private lenders. There's some concern that the reduced regulations that had been put into place to monitor for-profit colleges, and that there will be a lessening of that. Haven't seen it yet. Could happen. Obviously the ACA and any changes that are made in the Affordable Care Act could have a direct impact on the hospital and our funding in that way. So, it remains to be seen. Again, there is an expectation. Schumer's role is pretty significant, and I think it's useful that we have a good relationship with Schumer. Trump is from New York. We have many of our folks who know or are friends with, and so I think that we are okay on both sides, but, there's no crystal ball yet in terms of where things are going to go at the federal level. We intend to sort of deepen our federal relations practice to make sure that we're with the agencies, with the funders, with the granting authorities, that they understand the research that we do here, and we will keep that up. Sort of a tighten your seatbelt, off we go to the races, kind of legislative thing.
It's a very interesting environment, and I think, we're still sorting things out, but we certainly, are trying to make sure we know what our priorities are going forward and what are the areas that we think are most important for us to be advocating for and to be on top of. And again, we're benefited to some degree by organizations like AAU and APLU, which again are also have agents in Washington who really monitor the House and the Senate very closely, as well as the executive branch. So that provides another source for us that's very important. Ken, you want to just quickly, you know, talk about kind of the issues around the hospital dish and that I alluded to earlier?
Yeah, so as you all know, we are a safety net hospital. Safety net, by definition, caring for the underserved of Suffolk County. Just to put a few numbers on that, we take care of about 130,000 people who are underserved at our hospital, the majority of them in ambulatory settings, but almost 9,000 patients who are admitted to our hospital have Medicaid or have no ability to pay for their hospitalization. And even the Medicaid patients, as you know, we get about 67 cents on the dollar on a Medicaid patient. Now, up until current year, the state and the feds have combined to provide what are called DISH dollars, disproportionate share dollars. And on an average year, we will get about $100 to $110 million in DISH payments to break even on those Medicaid and no-pay patients. This year, and DISH is paid in two checks. They're paid in September and they're paid in April. So we were anticipating a $50 million check in September.
And just to interrupt for a second, I'm sorry. This is for services already provided.
3 years.
So the payment is for services we've already provided. So it's not for going forward to provide support. These are services already provided, patients we took care of, bills that have been approved. All of this is work that was done that we're supposed to be reimbursed by the state for. And we're told that the state and federal government will reimburse us for this. So just to be clear on what this money represents.
Mm-hmm. So $50 million in September. September came and went, no check. October came and went, no check. November, we checked. The check is in the mail. December, January, the check showed up, and it was $34 million short. So over the last 6 years, we have been growing our services, growing our budgets. We are slightly positive every year. We bring that money back in. This year, we are anticipating about a $4 million black ink bottom line, which would have, of course, been plowed back into the infrastructure, plowed back into programs. And now we're projecting, because of the $34 million shortfall, if it's not made up, will be minus $30 million. That's just the numbers. We don't know what's going to happen in April. Now, add to that the risk of the Affordable Care Act going away. So again, based on trends, based on the number of patients we see, we anticipate that if the Affordable Care Act were eliminated tomorrow, and the patients who came to Stony Brook with Medicaid, who are in that gap between where the Affordable Care Act, one of the biggest benefits for us was that it raised the family income needed to qualify for Medicaid. So in the old days, I'll put it in today's terms, in the old days, if you were a family of four, you qualified for Medicaid if your family of four income was $24,000 a year. Because of the Affordable Care Act, it's now about $34,000 a year. The difference between 24 and 34 has brought to Stony Brook about another 1,100 patients who have now Medicaid. I challenge you, if you have a $26,000 family income in your family of four, you can't afford a $10,000 or a $20,000 hospitalization at any hospital. So that gap has created a potential further decrease of $23 million to our budget. So that our mission as a safety net hospital, which we dearly value, which we are very proud of, we are without question the biggest provider of underserved individuals in Suffolk County. Each year it's either NUMIC, Nassau University Medical Center, or Stony Brook, which has the most undercare patients in their hospital. We value this mission, and I think we deliver outstanding care to those patients. But with the threats of the DISH dollars dwindling, with the threat of the Affordable Care Act going away and not being replaced, particularly that Medicaid piece, we are under a lot of stress, financial stress at Stony Brook.
And have we spelled that out to like Congressman Zeldin and the rest of our congressional delegation?
So we have talked, the precipitation in DISH dollars, that $34 million reduction was initiated by the state of New York. The way this works is dollars are taken from the state of New York, sent to CMS, to the feds, and it's matched by CMS dollars, which come back and pay our, in this case, $50 million. The state cut back on their amount, so the feds have cut back on their amount of matching funds, and that's where that
I think Kevin's
also alluding to the Affordable Care Act.
Right. Yes.
Oh, that
right.
Part, yes.
The repeal of that.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, the ACA going away, Congressman Zeldin would be a perfect person. Yeah, well,
I think both issues.
Well, he should certainly, and our entire congressional delegation should be made aware of the consequences of repealing Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act. But then in terms of Albany, this is also something we need to be dealing with then as well.
And we've spoken with Senator Flanagan and Senator LaValle and Senator
Are we the only safety net hospital in Suffolk County?
Yes.
Only so even with the entire Catholic health system and all their hospitals?
We take care of more underserved than they do.
Interesting.
So we've been pushing this issue. I've visited Albany. I'm going up again today. We're continuing to push this very hard, but there's really a misconception somehow that, you know, there's money in SUNY somewhere to, you know, make this up for the SUNY hospitals, because they're unique in being, you know, they've been singled out, by the way. So the University of New York hospitals have been singled out for this. Other hospitals have been getting DISH money. So we've been singled out in some way by the state. And there seems to be a misconception that we're going to take the money from Buffalo State, for example, and that's going to go and pay for this. And that's clearly not going to happen. So, you know, we need to make that crystal clear to people.
Linda, you have a question?
Yeah, going back to the Excelsior free tuition program, and forgive me for not knowing this, do we accept the maximum number of students that we can every year, or is there capacity to add more students if there's an influx of applications?
So there's some capacity to add more students, and we've been spending a lot of time, and Matt has led a team, you know, with ample assistance from the provost and others, that's been looking at what our capacity is to add. But it turns out that, you know, in the current financial situation, that we can't afford to add too many more students. I've actually been pushing for us to grow a little bit, but just based on the constraints in terms of the amount of tuition that we're able to charge, in terms of the other costs associated, uncertainty about some of the funding going forward, we can't add a lot of students. I think there would be, under this plan, under Excelsior, my guess is there would be some increase in demand for Stony Brook, but I don't think we could grow to accommodate perhaps everybody. I just don't know yet how it would play out, but it's a really good question.
Just quick, what's the maximum family income now to receive TAP aid?
90?
80.
Oh,
80. 80, 80,
80. So is the free college tuition essentially, that's what they're calling it, is it really just an expanded TAP program?
In a way it is, but it's not structured that way because it's that last dollar piece that Judy talked about. If it was structured as TAP, although the effect on us essentially would be as if it was an increase in TAP for all intents and purposes, which actually to a certain extent hurts us. Because for all of those $250 increased students that the governor's plan would give us, we would have to cover that. So the amount that we would actually generate from any kind of rational tuition plan over 5 years, a lot of it would be eaten away by the having to cover the extra $250.
So Kevin, the TAP scale runs from $250 for the year.
Correct.
To $5,000. And so a family could get $250 worth of TAP. That would be their TAP. Under Excelsior, we may have to cover up to the remainder, up to the cost of tuition. And so that's what we're wrestling with right now.
Would he be in Stony Brook?
Stony Brook. So before...
So it's not additional state dollars helping? Is it a mandate on the universities to make up the free part?
Well, yes, in a sense, it's not a mandate, but the way they're covering the cost is part of the cost is being covered by the state.
So this is a great discussion, and I think Bob was going to go into more to it, but I think the challenge for us is we approve of the principle of this, obviously, you know, and just what Jim was talking about today, we approve the principle of providing more people the opportunity to have access at Stony Brook. We're very much supportive of that principle. The challenge is to construct a program that actually allows us to maintain excellence and doesn't actually cost us money for these new students we're admitting. That's the idea. So that's why I think I've asked the team working with Buffalo and other university centers to talk about how we could adjust this so that it met the goals, and yet, which, by the way, in full disclosure, would probably require more state money coming in to support it, right? But would meet the goals, but allow us to actually do what it's intended to do, but without us ending up diverting money that we don't have, essentially, to support students, and that's the biggest challenge. I think we haven't mentioned the fact that, you know, that everybody knows, though, is that last year we got no tuition increase, we got no increase in state allocation, we took on another $8 million in additional salary costs. That's, you know, not counting the impact of inflation or anything else, just another $8 million salary cost. So we essentially had an $8 million cut to our budget is how we look at it. And so we can't keep doing that. And this program actually, if implemented the way people have talked about, would create problems for us. So I think, as I said, we're in favor of the principle, but we need to craft it in a way that it doesn't require us to keep making up these gaps between first students, which, again, I want someone to make up the gap. It's just I don't want it to come out of Stony Brook's budget per se, because then it's a negative for us in accepting those students, essentially. And we're better off taking students at higher income levels who can, you know, pay. That's not how we do our admissions, and we're not going to do our admissions that way, but it just creates this kind of challenge for us.
Okay. All right. So. We'll save any additional questions on the free college until after Bob does his presentation. Any additional questions for Judy on her presentation? I have a comment and a question. First, Bob's successor, Rob Mojica, asked me and Kathy Weil from the New York City Partnership back in December to try to pull together some of the life sciences initiatives. So we dragged Abe into it, and also I dragged Peter Donnelly, Sam's treasure tech person. And he also brought in Noel Goddard, who was over at the SBU incubator at Calverton, who is now working for us at Accelerate. So we've been in the mix of trying to pull that $650 million life science initiative. So I think Stony Brook's pretty well covered on the small committee of people who have been involved with that. But Judy, you know, the governor's also getting a lot of criticism over his Startup New York, you know, program. My understanding is that Stony Brook, we've actually been pretty successful with the program. Do we have any stats on companies that have participated and success, or is that person not here?
So they're not here. So Jakob's not here. But we have, I think, 18 companies at this point in time that are new as part of Startup. That number has changed a little bit because we've had some companies withdraw that were in before. I think it's really been flat. Part of that is space. Part of that is promotion. The state really hasn't been promoting it recently, but part of it, I think, is just also space. Our incubator is filled. Our Leidy incubator is filled. We're building this mezzanine building, which is going to decant the incubator. I think when that happens, I think we may see more companies coming in, depending on, you know.
Some companies will grow to the mezzanine building.
Some companies are going to go to the mezzanine building. That's definitely going to free up space in the existing building, so I think we're going to be open for more business. We're number two right now in SUNY, but Buffalo has significantly more companies than we do. But they also had a lot of empty space, essentially, in some buildings that they were able to put companies in. So I don't, you know, I think that I said, I think, in my letter to News, hey, I think the verdict is still out on this. The Excelsior is a little change to it. The Hotspot program, which is similar to Startup, has been attracting some companies as well. It's a little different form of incentive for companies to come. But our challenge has been, you know, it's hard for us to go out and market this right now, even individually, as opposed to the state marketing it, because we don't have any space to put people. So, you know, we're really pretty limited. When the mezzanine building goes up, when iDimes goes up, I think we're going to have some more space, essentially, and then I think we could be more aggressive about trying to recruit for those programs. I think we are in a good place in terms of the kind of science and resources we have here to continue to be attractive, both in terms of this new biotechnology initiative, life sciences initiative, as well as in what we do in IT. I think we're in a good place, but right now we're just kind of space limited. So that's why those buildings are important. And I'm grateful to the state for putting the investment into those buildings, but I think it'll help us compete. It's great. A great question.
Great, good to hear. All right, thanks, Judy. Next up is Bob Vegna, who's going to talk about free college and other budget challenges.
Judy went over a lot of this, so I'll try to go fast over those pieces. Again, it's a program that gradually gets to $125,000, so the first year, actually, the cutoff is $100,000, then it grows to $125,000. We talked about it being a last dollar program. Only tuition costs are covered, not room and board. Award, again, this Judy touched on this, 4 years of full-time study. So if you drop behind on full-time study or you fail a class, you're out of the program, essentially. Again, part-time students and undocumented students are not eligible. That's a little bit, you know, in conflict with the DREAM Act piece, but again, that they're probably balancing costs and other issues there. And the projected cost of the program is about $163 million statewide. Part-time is a big issue for CUNY, for example, where because CUNY and SUNY are eligible under this program. Again, it's probably wrong to say all the details of the execution are not finalized. It probably would be better to say, as currently written, there are some issues that probably need to be addressed. So there's really no phase-in in the current plan above the $125,000 cutoff. So if some family earned $125,001, their child wouldn't be eligible for the program. Usually you don't run programs like that. Usually there's some sort of phase out range to that cutoff. So that's an issue. Is the projected cost of $163 million accurate? You know, it seems a little low, but I think part of the reason why is because some of the costs actually do get borne at the university level and some are borne kind of across the board. But I was actually talking to some folks up in Albany with the other part-time job I have, and their calculation was based on a you know, relatively small number of students that they believe are in this range. So that's where the $163 million estimate came from. Again, the issues for us are, will Stony Brook be required to offer tuition credit, hold harmless as currently provided? I think the answer is partially yes. As it's currently written, again, as I understand it, the program says if we increased our tuition by $250, any kid that enters the program who's eligible under the program, that kid's tuition is fixed for his 4 years at Stony Brook. So if we were increasing tuition by $250, for the rest of the student body over that period, we couldn't recover it on those kids. We'd have to make up the difference.
So that's, in a nutshell, something that, you know, I would think needs to be changed. Our costs, you know, that $250 is designed to help us deal with the cost of the salary increases, with the cost of inflation, all the things we've talked about that are costs for us that are going to increase no matter what. And so not giving us the ability to increase that particular thing then creates essentially for us what's going to be a problem in for those students.
And then I think the others are just questions we don't know the answer to, which will, you know, how will the cutoff grow with inflation in the future, or will it? And how will the spending program impact future SUNY appropriations? There's no MOE, and Judy mentioned that. One of the, I think, classic dimensions of 2020, Kevin, you asked this question, was that tuition could increase, but the appropriation could not be cut. Now, there was debate over what a flat appropriation meant, my view in my old job was flat, meant flat. But at least there was some agreement that you couldn't go below that. Now, what used to happen in years past was if there was a large tuition increase, the state would cut the subsidy and, in a sense, capture part of the tuition increase at the state level. So there's nothing that would prevent them from doing that in the future, and that's the danger of not having an MOE. But there isn't one now. This kind of just gives the basics of, you know, what's currently the case. So essentially, in this column, these are folks that essentially are no tuition after all existing programs, which is basically TAP, SUNY Hold Harmless, Pell Grants, and all of the other grants that are available. So we have about 4,000 students that are currently tuition free. And most of them, I think these are just data errors, quite honestly, the 5 and the 2. So it's everyone below, you know, 75K, and that's 0 to 75K. Remember, TAP right now caps out at 80,000. If you do the governor's program as we understand it, it would add folks kind of in this kind of proportion. So we would add roughly, in the first year, about 2,800 students, and then when fully phased in again, almost another 4,000. So in total, it would be almost 8,000 students for which we were covering full tuition, which would be about $15.7 million worth. And 8,000 is roughly half our undergraduate population. Matt, anything you'd add to that?
Right. And we don't get any tuition increase from those students. So by the third year, that's about $6 million.
So you need to clarify for everybody, and or just perhaps for me. I think we'll put that back up again. So I think we've talked about it before, but that $15.7 million, that's what would be owed to Stony Brook for Excelsior, right? So that's what would be owed for us. But as it's currently constructed, we might be responsible for some of that, or that does that count the gap we would be responsible for making up or not?
So we
is that what on a flat tuition or
no? We think that we could lose as much as half of that amount back if we had to cover that amount.
Okay. So that's right. So I think,
Which in context is if we, without any increase in the state subsidy, just salary increases would more than cover any tuition increase that we would do under that scenario. So we'd still be in a kind of net negative position.
Right.
But go ahead.
I would just say another way to look at it is the 15.73 is what we should be getting from the 163 that was put aside for Excelsior.
Right.
One question is, I mean, we've seen dish payments not come our way. So one question is, would we actually get that, especially if there's no MOE, if there are cuts, would we actually get that? And then on top of it is that we would forego tuition from students that other tuition increases over the life.
For half of the undergraduates, essentially.
For half the undergraduates. Right. So that 250, even if we got authority, are now we're cutting the number of students who would be paying that, which is a significant lessening of our revenue.
Right.
And on top of that, we're still paying the TAP gap.
Right.
I'm a little confused. Do we need the predictable tuition increase plan to help make the Excelsior Scholarship Program work? And then two, is the predictable tuition increase plan, is that going to apply to all students or just the non-TAP students? Because if we're making college more expensive for them, how does that financially impact the Excelsior Scholarship Program?
So currently, under City 2020, when tuition was increased, the institute for students who were on TAP, they did not pay that increase. The institution picked it up. That's what we call the TAP gap.
Got it. Okay.
And that number was never reset from the beginning of 2020. So students who came in, students still are paying 2011 tuition, and we're picking up the gap of any of those increases. One of the issues is that needs to get reset every year.
Right.
So that if you're coming in, your tuition should be what the tuition is today. And if there's an increase and you're on TAP, they maintain the institution paying the TAP gap, we would pay that. It's complicated stuff.
And what percentage
of the
students?
This, we'd still pay that.
We'd still pay that.
We'd still pay that. Plus, for everyone under 125, we couldn't recover the extra 250 if we were allowed to.
Because the state doesn't want to pay, in their calculation of $163 million, they're not calculating a tuition increase in that. They're saying, we'll just pay what the tuition is that year, when the year they come in, but we're not going to pay any increases on tuition as we reimburse you for Excelsior. So that's our point, is that, so yes, we want the $250 increase, because that helps us with the other half of the students who actually would be paying the increase in tuition, but it doesn't help us essentially with the Excelsior students, because they wouldn't pay it. So what I would like to see is that Excelsior as a plan would also pay for these modest, and remember it's $250 a year, less than a dollar a day, these modest tuition increases that we're expecting would be covered as part of the Excelsior plan, that we could charge these students, if their tuition was now $6,500, then after you put in the TAP, after you put in federal funding, whatever that gap is, counting that $250, Excelsior would pay that. That's what I'd like to see changed on the plan. It's not our responsibility to, quote, hold harmless those students, but rather for the state to assume that responsibility and increase our state allocation through the Excelsior program to help us do that.
That sounds very logical and rational.
Yes.
So if now's the time to be helping to shape.
It is. It is. This is why we're having these conversations. I'll have to say that most of the criticism of Excelsior right now has focused on the tight eligibility requirements in terms of 15 credits, in terms of having to graduate in 4 years. Most of the people are criticizing, I'd say are criticizing more on that, and they're also asking how it's gonna be paid for, as opposed to that issue of who's actually paying for it, which is, I think, again, the challenge for us. So I think we need to, as I said, we are coming up with a very discrete list of modifications to the program that we think would actually make it better, and still achieve the governor's laudable goal, but make it actually work for the institutions.
Would any of those recommendations also help address some of the concerns of the private colleges? A number of them have reached out to me as well. They're large employers on Long Island, and they serve on the LIA board with Linda and Sam and myself. But are their concerns totally different than our concerns, or are some of their concerns similar, and could we address both the public and the private institutions with some of these recommendations?
I think putting aside the issue of the $500 limit, which I think is challenging for both public and private institutions to deal with, and probably not realistic in terms of how costs rise for our sector. I think the issues are probably different. Do you agree?
Yes. Yeah. I think so. Yeah. I think